Well, good morning. Excellent. It's a great pleasure to be here in front of you, with you, today to talk about something that I'm sure you are as passionate about as I am. We have this luxury. We have this luxury to work in a field that transcends almost every aspect of human life. Not everybody can have that kind of a claim to what they do professionally. We could work in various different industries, and yet we could be doing what we're doing, writing software. This is an amazing field to be in. One of the things that we have to always deal with on a daily basis is, how do we really contend with complexity? And that seems to creep in all along. But it reminds me of an experience. I traveled quite a bit, and on a recent trip, I was in the airplane sitting next to a gentleman, and he asked me, what do I do for a living? And I said, I'm a programmer. And he said, well, that's the easiest job on earth. I said, well, I'm glad somebody feels that way. Can you tell me why? And he said, because all you have to know is zeros and ones. And I said, you know what? You're absolutely right. And that's why they pay me the big money, because I know in what sequence to put them in. And that's where the complexity really is, to really make sure we actually do what results in value to our customers, produces things that we can actually use. That takes a lot of time, a lot of effort. But one of the things we have to contend with every day is complexity. We come to work, imagine for a minute the project you joined, and the first few weeks of the project, how were things? Everybody was still smiling at each other, right? You said hello when you walked into the office, life was really good. And about 6 months into the project, what happened? Nobody wants to talk to anybody anymore, right? We quietly are working, we work late in the night, things have become really hard. Why do things become complex over time? What really makes things hard for us? Well, we'll talk about some of the reasons, but also how to cope with some of those here today. So I want to talk about something that is extremely complex. But this complexity is a good thing. And I want to replace the word complex with the word capable for just a few minutes. Because sometimes certain things are very capable, and it's worth its complexity. And one of the most capable things we can ever have is, we have several of those in this room, which is the brains that each one of us has. And each of our brain is probably the most capable thing we can ever think of. All the devices, all the marvels, all the software we build, they all came from just one place. That's the human brain, isn't it? We are extremely creative, we are very talented, we can come up with ideas like nobody can. And yet there is something really funny about the human brain. It is the same brain that goes through emotions. It's the same brain that goes through confusion. It's the same brain that leads us to think in a very irrational way sometimes. And emotions cloud us, and we are not able to see the clear picture. Things get fogged up in front of us. And then, of course, eventually things clear up. But why do we do that, right? That's kind of where it gets very interesting to think about. And we tend to really analyze things, and things are very complex until we can gain clarity on those things. This reminds me of a thought experiment that this was done back in the 1930s. Einstein and people working with him were talking about quantum physics. And it was really hard to understand quantum physics back then, as it is probably right now for several of us. And this guy whose picture is here is called Schrodinger. And this is a conversation that I have a lot of times with my children. At home, a lot of times the conversation is, Dad, is it like a Schrodinger's cat? So Schrodinger's cat is our actually pet at our house, in fact. So we talk about Schrodinger's cat quite a bit. And Schrodinger came up with a thought experiment. He said that if there's a cat that's put into this box, and there's no windows into this box, you cannot look through this box at all. And if you're peering through this box, you cannot see inside of it. And within this box, there's a vial, and the vial may break at a random time, and immediately as soon as the vial breaks, the cat would get killed. So the question is the cat alive or is the cat dead? Well, you cannot say whether it's alive or dead at any time, and if you try to open the box to see, it will be dead instantaneously. So his argument is, at any given time, a cat is both dead or alive. Now, how do you really reason that? Things get really confusing, and Schrodinger's cat is dead and alive at the same time. Well, we contend with complexity all through our lives. And as Confucius says, that we deal with this every day when we deal with people. And Confucius says, life is really simple, but we insist on making things extremely complicated. Now, why do we make things complex? Now, I think I have a few reasons I know why we make things complex. Now, I'll tell you the most important reason why we make things complex. It feels good. Honestly, doesn't it? It feels good when you make things complex, right? Because you are looking at a design, you worked on it, you go to your colleague and say, can you take a look at my design? And your colleague looks at your design and says, yeah, that's simple. You feel let down. You say, what do you mean it's simple? Give it to me. I'll bring it back tomorrow. And then the next day you take back the design and your colleague says, oh boy, it hurts my head. It's like, yeah, right? We feel good about it, right? Complexity makes us feel we are important. Now, if you look at somebody and say, well, you probably hire an intern. And the first day after the internship, the intern runs back to college and says, this company I'm interning with, it's really cool because I don't have a clue what they're doing, right? And that makes it feel more important too, right? And there's another reason why complexity is so good. Complexity naturally brings us job security. When it comes to layoff, they say, lay off anybody in this team but Joe, don't touch Joe. We have no clue what Joe is doing. Maybe it's important, right? So complexity leads to job security as well. And we think that people who do simple things are useless, right? Anybody can do what they do. But this guy who's doing complex things, he's got to be good because we don't understand what he's doing. So there are several of these reasons why we build complexity, because it feels good. Now, complexity is like eating donuts. Well, okay, or it is like eating vadas or name your jalebis, whatever that you want to talk about. Have you ever had a chance to eat one of them and stop? No, I was teaching a course in a company, and these people were really tricky. They put donuts right in front of me. Can you imagine how hard it is to actually stand in front of food like 3 feet away and not touch it? And I tried really hard, right? Every few minutes you get drawn towards it and you tell yourself, no, I don't need to do it. And the human brain is very tricky. Eventually it says, it's okay, you can have one. And what happens when you have one? Have you ever had a chance to eat one and say, this was good, I'm done? No, the minute you have one, the next thing you know, you're pipelining more of them, right? And complexity is like that. The minute you create something complex, the next time you have to create something more complex. And there's yet another thing. Your colleague created complex things, tomorrow you've got to create something even more complex, right? So it becomes a competition on complexity as well. So you've got to deal with all of these. Well, Einstein said, any intelligent fool can create something that's bigger, more complex, and more violent, but it takes a touch of genius and courage to really make things complex. And I would say more than a genius, it really takes courage. And it takes a lot of courage to move in the opposite direction. A lot of courage to say, I am actually going to create something simple, and I'm not going to make this complex. And so it takes courage to really create something simple, and that is really hard. Now, the question I would ask you is, if simple was sitting next to you in the bus, would you even know and say, oh, you are Mr. Simple, aren't you? How would we even recognize simplicity? And that's the problem. Most of us don't even know what is simple. The other day I was complaining endlessly that a particular code was complex. And the person who reviewed the code, wrote the code, looked at me and said, why do you think this code is complex? I said, look at this code, it's complex. Why would you even ask it's complex? And the person said, I don't understand, Venkat, what's your problem? Notice, all I've used is a simple if statement, only a 40 of it. Why is this complex? And that's when I understood people don't know what complexity really is. They said, of course, if it's simple, so I can use 40 of them, so this code is still simple. Well, the code has enormous amount of duplication in it, and that is complexity. There's a lot of redundancy in it. That's complexity. The code is hard to understand. That's complexity. The code is hard to refactor and maintain and make change to it. That's complexity. So there are complexity we have to deal with, but the first step in removing complexity is identifying complexity. If we don't even know what's complex and what's simple, how could we possibly create something that's simple? So that's the first step. How do we really create simple things? Now, unfortunately, it turns out it's really hard to find and create things simple. So rather than telling you what is simple first, I'll tell you what is not simple. How about that? Well, if we know what is not simple, we could at least remove what's not simple and maybe hope that what's left behind is actually simple. So let's talk about what's not simple. The very first thing is simple is not clever. Now, let's think about this for a minute. Is there anybody here, raise your hand, if you have never written a clever code? Anybody who's never written a clever code? The only person who would raise the hand is the person who has never written code in the first place, right? Yeah. Everybody else has written a clever code. Why? Because it feels good to write clever code. I remember this experience very, very well. I was writing something, and I had a problem to solve. And I could have solved this problem in about 5 minutes. But then I looked at this and said, whoa, look at how I can solve this problem tenfold over. And I spent another hour writing a piece of code. And when I finished it, I was so proud, I literally gave a pat on my own back. And I said, Venkat, you're good. This is awesome. And it was very clever, so I was very happy. Checked in the code, moved on. About 3 months went by, and I got a call from the support. And the support said, we are calling from production, and something royally messed up. Can you please help fix the problem? I looked at the problem, and within about 2 minutes, I said, I know what the problem is, I can fix it. And the team said, I know you're good, but we didn't know you're that good. How do you find this problem so quickly? I said, because I created it, right? Because I remember the day I created something really clever, and I knew what the problem is. I put my head down, and I went back and did the code that would have been done in 5 minutes, because that was the real solution. And I rolled back my code, and the problem was gone. And I learned a very tough lesson that day. It is that when you create clever code, be ready to come back and do some more work on it. It is ready to embarrass you. Now, these days, you can ask me, Venkat, do you ever write clever code? Well, you know, I'm a human. So I'm sitting there writing code. As soon as I finish writing the code, I tell myself, wow, that's clever. Immediately, I delete the code and start over. I don't want clever code anymore. I want clear code. Let's talk about some examples for a minute. Let's take a look at this example. What does it say here? Well, let's see what it says. It says, public class, well, abstract class, enum, e, extends enum, e. Yeah, I can see his reactions like, what? Oh, and the noise you just heard? That's your brain throwing an exception, right? You're like, what the heck does that mean? That is an example of complexity, right? Now, of course, this is exactly how enum is implemented in Java. If you go back and look at enum in Java, that is exactly what enum in Java is. JDK 5 has this, right? Java 5 has this. Now, what does that do? Well, I'm sure we can all explain what it does. But I bet you, if I ask the same question next week, you'll spend as much time, if not longer, thinking about it again. That is a sign of complexity. Because every time you look at it, you have to stare and say, what in the world is it doing? That becomes really hard. Now, the other day I was visiting a team and they said, hey, Venkat, what tool do you recommend for us to obfuscate the code because we don't want anybody to look at our code and understand what tool can we use for obfuscation? And I said, why? Because your programmer naturally writes self-obfuscated code. They themselves cannot understand it after they write it. Why do you need a tool, right? So we create code that's hard to maintain, so clever code is self-obfuscated. It's very difficult for us to understand what the code is doing. Let's take a look at an example here. Well, take a look at that code for a second. What does that code do? Well, let's understand what the code is doing. There is a method called in squared. It takes float x. Anybody knows what x is? I got some good news for you. Whatever x is, we don't know, but we have half of it. That's great, isn't it? And then, of course, we do this operation. Now, don't tell me you don't understand this. This is very obvious, right? It is star int star ampersand x. Now, you cannot say you don't know it, because somebody wrote it. We got to be smart enough to understand this, right? And then what does it do? This is fantastic. It is obvious what it is doing, right? And whatever it does, the good news is we eventually return X. Life is in harmony, right? Now look at that code, and if you are the person who should maintain that code, well, how would you feel? How would you feel when you have to go home that night? That's the reason why we don't go home, right? We stay at work, right? We don't want to go face the family and say, why are you all grumpy at the end of the day? Well, because that's the kind of nonsense I have to put up with every day, right? Now, I'm sure you come across somebody who writes code like this at work. And you're trying to be nice to this person. Of course, this person says, this is obvious, right? But you don't know, but you say, you know what? This is very obvious to you. But what about the rest of the team? What would they do? How would they be able to deal with the code? And your colleague says, don't worry, we got them covered. And what does your colleague say? You do something like this, right? So he says, I've got X plus plus, and then they do something very, very valuable, very useful. Increment. That was very helpful, wasn't it? And we put all these comments in code. Have you ever seen comments like that? Absolutely. What are those comments? They're called insult. It's an insult to the programmers, right? Because it says what the code is doing, like shift. Thanks. I was not sure if there was an increment or maybe something else. But the real question is, why did you do it? What's the purpose of doing it? What is the effect of doing it? Are there conditions when we should do this and conditions when we shouldn't do it? And most of the time, comments don't tell us. And comments tell us what is obvious being an insult to us, the programmers. So the code becomes extremely hard to understand and hard to read as time goes on. Now remember, I'm sure you have read this before, right? They said object-oriented programming is great because object-oriented programming models the real world. Have you heard that? Well, one guy took that very literally, and he was writing a flight simulator, and so he created this. How do you maintain a code like this? Somebody has got to say, stop. Take a break. Go get some fresh air, right? How do you maintain code like this? So the first thing is that simple code is not clever. So if you're writing code that is clever, rewrite it. Don't document or comment clever code, refactor it. So it becomes easy to understand the code, easy to maintain it. That is very important. The next thing I'll say about simple is, simple is not necessarily familiar. Now, this is very confusing to a lot of us. We hear this a lot. Now, does anybody know what this is in this room? Anybody? No?
Some Japanese character?
Well, actually that's the first step. I'm glad you actually recognize it as a character. It is actually a Chinese character. And I usually have somebody in the room who understands Chinese, and usually somebody blurts out saying, it is simple. Well, it is simple, uncomplicated, casual, common. How do you know? I Googled for it. Of course it's got to be true then, right? So it is simple. Now, if I show you this, you're going to say, I can understand. That is complex. But Chinese don't think so. They think it is simple. So what's going on here? So the other day I was showing a piece of code to somebody, and they said, oh my gosh, it is complex. And I said, it's complex. How do you say it's complex? I think it's simple. Oh no, look at all the things you have in there. That's confusing. And I was in a foreign country. I looked out to the street and said, do you see the street sign over there? He said, yeah. And I said, that's complex and confusing. And he said, no, it's obvious what the street sign is saying. I said, why? And he said, because it's in my mother tongue. It's something I understand. And I said, oh, so you're saying you are familiar with it. So oftentimes we confuse this term. When we say simple, that's a wrong term to use. It's not simple. It is what we are familiar with. And we have to ask ourselves, are we saying simple or are we saying familiar? Let's look at an example here. Let's say I want to take a bunch of prices, and I want to total the prices after I discount them 10%. How would I actually do this? Let's give it a try. So I'm going to take some price values, right? So I got some bunch of prices on my hand. You can see 10, 15, 20, bunch of values. I want to total these price values, but I want to discount each one of them by 10%. So what should I do? Well, let's say double total equal to 0 to first begin with, right? And then I'm going to output the value of total. And then I'm going to say for int I equal to 0, I less than prices dot, is it length or size? Size? Sure? Okay, size. Is it less than or equal to? Are you sure? Is it plus plus? You know where I'm going with that, right? What are we trying to do? Do a very simple task. And yet what are we doing? Asking these questions. Is it size or length? Is it less than or equal to? And then when you finish it 3 weeks later, somebody says, your code is wrong. And then we all probably say, oh, it's off by one error. How do you feel when you have off by one errors? That's totally stupid, right? That we have to put so much effort in doing such a simple task, a trivial task after all, to get this done. And if you notice this, that was quite an effort to get this done, actually, you can see this. I'm going to argue, if you show this code to somebody and say, what does this code do? What would they tell you? They would say, hang on, let me see what it does. Let me read and understand what it does. They need some time. And you ask them, what do they think about this code? They probably will tell you, oh, it's a simple code. But they got this term very confused. The word they are looking for is not the word simple. The word they are looking for is the word familiar. Almost everybody who writes code is familiar with this code. But I'm going to say this is one of the most complex code we could actually write. Now, why is this complex? It is familiar and complex. It is complex because what are you trying to really do? Find the total of all the values that are discounted. Instead, what are we really doing? Sitting there and looping. And what are we doing for looping? Hey, you first set a variable whose value is 0. Second, initialize the variable index to 0. Then make sure you increment it. Third, make sure you set the boundary conditions properly. Notice this is called dancing around. Notice how much more effort we put in to do this job here. And there are so many moving parts in this code. I saw Michael Feather's tweet one day. He said, in object-oriented programming, we encapsulate the moving parts. In functional programming, we eliminate the moving parts. What a great way to think about it. In object-oriented programming, we encapsulate the moving parts. In functional programming, we eliminate the moving parts. What's the benefit of eliminating the moving parts? When you have fewer moving parts, fewer things go wrong. Now, this code has way too many moving parts, way too many mutability. You are mutating the total variable several times, and you are mutating the variable I several times. There are more opportunities to get things wrong. Whereas when you have fewer moving parts, there are fewer errors. Fewer moving parts, easier to understand. Fewer moving parts, easier to change. Fewer moving parts, easier to make it concurrent. So what can we do about this code? Well, in Java 5, it's been around for, what, 10 years now? We already have an answer, which is much simpler than this. We could simply say total equal to 0, and rather than doing that, we could say int price in prices, and then we could say total plus equal to price times 0.9, which is the arithmetic we are really interested in doing, right? In the previous case, I didn't even do the multiplication. I was overwhelmed by the amount of code I had to write. So this is a lot simpler. Notice both the code produce exactly the same result. If there are two pieces of code that give you exactly the same result, which one should you choose? The one that is doing less effort to get you that result. The one with fewer moving parts to get you the result. The one that is easier to maintain to get the result. Not necessarily the one that is the most familiar. Because I may be familiar only to ride a bicycle, but you cannot tell me there should be no airplanes in this world, right? So we have to look for efficiency, productivity as well. That becomes very critical. So in this case, the for loop that we have here is much better. So we should never use the other for loop unless maybe we have to manage manipulation of an index variable. But if all that we're trying to do is loop through, why would we want to use the old for loop? Well, we can do a lot better than this. We could do a lot better than this. How? Let's give it a try. So notice what I'm going to do now. I completely remove the variable. I can have it if I wanted to, but I don't have to. I'm going to simply say output, and I'm going to say prices dot, and I'm going to call upon a very fancy iterator. This fancy iterator called stream is available in Java 8 now. And I can say on this, map to double, and given a price value, give me a price times 0.9, and then once I get the value out of it, simply do the sum operation on it and get me the result. Now notice how we change the code, and we're not even using an external for loop in this code. But what is the benefit? Shockingly, I show this code, and I can tell you how many times people look at this code and say, oh, it is complex. And I remind them, I'm sorry, the word you're looking for is unfamiliar. When I'm unfamiliar with something, what does my brain tell me? Run. This is different. This is strange. You better be scared about it. Right? This is human nature. We cannot really work around that. We have to deal with it. Our human nature is, when you see something different, be scared of it. This is inborn in us. Why? We had to, and lived in caves. Well, it was a while back, right? Because we had to put up with danger all the time. And so immediately our body reflects back. I was jogging this morning, the beautiful streets around here, I was jogging this morning, and a tree leaf fell on me. And the first reaction, oh, what was it? Right? That's the human nature. I laugh every time that happens, right? And then the minute you realize it's a leaf, you're like, oh, I can handle that, right? So the point really is that we get scared. That's our human nature, to be scared. And when you look at something very unfamiliar, your brain throws all kinds of exceptions on you and says, run, this is different. In other words, you are afraid because you are stepping out of your comfort zone. Think about this for a minute. We all are working as programmers. And we wake up in the morning, have a nice shower, have some nice breakfast, we get to work, and we start coding. And we got them so good, we don't even get as many compiler errors anymore. And that is when you know you are in trouble. Why? Because you have become so comfortable. When you are fresh out of college, you knew almost nothing. And you were learning everything you can. You made all the mistakes you can. And people said, that's okay, you're young, you are fresh, we'll give you help. And then we get a little bit of experience. And then we tell ourselves, I cannot make mistakes anymore. If I don't make mistakes, I'm good. If I make mistakes, others will laugh at me. And they will tell me, don't you even know this? So what do? Oh, I know exactly how to not make mistakes. If I don't do anything I don't know, I will never make a mistake. So what do? We draw a comfort circle. And as we become more experienced, what do? We broaden the comfort circle. And now we are so comfortable in the comfort circle. We stand on it, we sit on it, we can lay down on it, and everything works. And then what do? We defend our territory. And we tell people, you dare not to come and change what I do, because I'm very good at what I do, and I don't want to be brought back at the bottom of the stack, climbing up again, right? So we become very comfortable. And the more comfortable we become, it becomes very difficult to learn something different. And we start rejecting those violently, saying, no, 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 that's complex. We don't want that stuff. Think about this for a minute. Take an example of a very small child, 7 months old, maybe, or maybe 14 months old, I don't know. Different children walk at different pace. This child is just about beginning to stand up and take a first few steps. Beautiful to watch this, right? And what does the child do? Takes two steps and falls down. Immediately falls down. Now, there are a couple of things we can do at this point. My wife and I decided way back when we had little children, my children are grown up now, but when they were very small, my wife and I agreed that when the children fall down, we'll pretend like we never noticed. And we will make sure, we kind of look, glance through and make sure they're not bleeding or something, right? We don't want to be them to suffering through bleeds. So they would fall down, and what do? The minute they fall down, they immediately get up and they look around very quietly. And they look at where mom and dad is, or where the nanny is, where the grandma is. And if nobody's paying attention, what does the kid do? Wipes and walks away, right? But instead, as parents, what do? I mean, this is one thing I learned. So my wife and I, this was hard, but we did this. And my children never threw a tantrum. Never. There was not a single day we had tantrums in our children. They would never cry in public. The minute they start crying, we would say, reason it. And they would immediately stop crying and reason and do stuff. And it's a very different experience. Why don't children cry like that? Well, this is what my reasoning is. The child falls down and gets up and looks around. What do? Oh, child, did you fall down? You rush towards the child, and the child looks up and there's a giant coming towards. Wouldn't you be scared if a giant leaps on you? And the child freaks out and cries, not because the child fell down. That's because a monster is trying to run over the child, right? Or so it feels. Poor children. And then they cry every time they learn they fall down. Why? Because the minute they fall down, they say, oh, here comes the monster again running towards me. And the children get together and they tell themselves, my parents are really good people, except when they fall down, right? And the children are just tarnished forever. So try this, right? Don't bother. Just keep quiet when the child falls down. See what happens. Nothing happens. They just get up and go around. And falling down, making mistake, is natural for us. Until sometime along the way, people tell us, our society tells us, how silly of you, you fail. And then we think, oh my God, I couldn't fail anymore. What if failure becomes what we do every single day? What if I don't mind failing at all? What happens then? Then that's freedom, right? Freedom to learn, freedom to experiment, freedom to try something new, freedom to make a fool out of myself, and only to get better at what I do. And there's nothing. In our field, we really have very little to lose by trying new things. It is so easy to try new things. So this one is very unfamiliar. But I'm going to argue this is extremely simple. How is it simple? Let's read what this code is telling us. It says, given prices, find the discounted value of all the prices and total. Oh my gosh, look at what just happened. The code begins to read like the problem statement all of a sudden. There's a one-to-one mapping between what the problem statement tells us and what the code is doing. There are no moving parts in this code. This is declarative programming. And there are no loops to deal with. The loop becomes internal and automated. It becomes a lot more easier to work with. This is unfamiliar to a lot of us, but once you become familiar, you quickly realize this is extremely simple and not so confusing and really hard. So we could write the code and evolve it towards simplicity very quickly. So the very first thing I would ask is, don't confuse what's familiar with what is simple. What we are familiar with may probably be very complex. In fact, I would argue most of us are like a boiling frog. You probably have heard of the story of the boiling frog. You take, I'm not suggesting you do this. This is very inhumane. So don't try this at home and say, Venkat mentioned this, right? Write the code that I ask you to do, but not the frog experiment. But they took a frog and they put it in a water at the room temperature. And the frog was happy just going around. And then they started turning on the heat. This is cruel. But they turned on the heat. Very small amount of heat. Like every 2 hours, it increases by 1 degree. And after several hours, the water was literally boiling and the frog didn't even feel it. We programmers are like that. We don't even feel this anymore. When we look at code like this, right, we have become this boiling frog. And we are like, oh, we can handle this. It's familiar, but it's complex. We are boiling in complexity. We don't feel a thing. Why? Because we are familiar. And that is why we have to be very aware of this. So then don't confuse familiar with simple. A lot of us are very familiar with imperative style of programming, but declarative style of programming is simpler if we become familiar with it. And we have to take the time to become familiar with the style of programming before we can appreciate its simplicity. Otherwise, we are condemned to stay with the complexity on the grounds of being familiar with something. So a simple has fewer moving parts. With fewer moving parts, fewer things go wrong. And that is something to keep in mind. So simple is not clever. Simple is not necessarily familiar. And the third thing I would say is, simple is not over-engineered. Now, over-engineering, nobody wants to create code. Everybody wants to create frameworks these days. Nobody wants to create usable code, they want to create reusable code. Grady Booch once said, let's create usable code first, then let's create reusable code, right? So that becomes very important to achieve that. But why do we create complexity? Well, because we want to make things extensible. Extensibility is this holy grail. I was talking to a company, and the manager said, hey, my team said every day we are creating extensible code. And after they went into production, the first change that came across, the team said they need 3 weeks to fix it. He said, why do you guys need 3 weeks to press this? And all that they had to do was just change one field. They need 3 weeks to it. He said, why does my team need 3 weeks when they told me they're creating extensible code? I said, it's your problem. He said, what did I do? And I said, the code was extensible until you asked them to extend it. If you never asked them to extend it, it would be still extensible, right? So the problem is, we all build extensible code, but you don't have a clue what extensibility is. Ralph Johnson, the author of one of the famous The Gang of Four books, once said, we create abstraction, we create encapsulation, we create hierarchy. We create hierarchy of interfaces and classes. Why do we do all of that? Because we want the code to be extensible. But in doing so, we have built so much complexity that when the time comes to make the change, the very effort we put into it makes it hard to make the change. So a simple solution is easier to change than a complex solution. Why? Because the change never comes based on what we anticipated. This comes from the off field. Oh, I never saw that coming. And when that comes over, it becomes hard to make the change to this code. That's where the complexity brews in. There's a guy named Rube Goldberg. He did a lot of these comic strips where he would create very complex designs. And he would show how we can make simple things very complex. He's got a lot of these comic strips. One of those is this one here. This is a very complicated system he built to enable back scratching. Now, I'm sure each one of us have built this at our company at one point or the other. I remember one day I was at work, and I was looking at a piece of code. This was taking data from a database and 200 lines of code to convert it to XML file, and then send this XML document across. And I took time to understand what this code was doing. Then I went to the code it was calling. And the code takes this XML coming in, 200 lines of code later, inserts it back into the database. And I'm like, okay. And I'm like, why did we do all of that? Why not just take the data and just insert it in this other place that you have to insert it into? So I called the programmer. And I said, hey, I'm looking at this code. And the programmer is very proud. Isn't that cool? No. Well, Venkat, that's really cool. Look at the flexibility it offers. I've got the data. Now I have an XML representation. The XML representation is here. I can put it back into the database. Isn't that cool? I said, no, I don't see it. Why is this cool? He said, Venkat, you're no fun. You should have the vision. I said, what vision do you want me to have? Look at how extensible this code really is. I said, how is it extensible? The data can come from anywhere in the world. The data can be sent to anywhere in the world. I said, in our application, where does the data come and go? From the database to database. Well, if that's our requirement, why are you doing this? He said, look at the flexibility you have. Tomorrow, you could do anything you want to do with this. It is 100% extensible. It doesn't matter where the boundaries are. This gives you absolute extensibility. And while he was talking, I was fiddling with my phone. And suddenly he said, excuse me. And he said, hello? I said, hello? I said, yeah, who is it?
Venkat.
Venkat, hey, are you calling me? I said, yes. Why are you calling me? I said, look at the possibility. How extensible this is. Why are we talking to each other? I could be anywhere in the world talking to you. So we should always talk to each other by phone, even when you're in front of me. Right? That's absolutely ridiculous, and yet we do this in code all the time. Because we want to build extensibility. Well, why don't we first understand and solve the real problem? Hey, how about getting the product out so people can actually use it? And give us a real feedback and say, well, your application sucks and here's how I want you to fix it. Let's solve real problems. Let's not solve problems that we create on ourselves. There's a name for these. These are called accidental complexity. And we have to really understand what these accidental complexities are. Because I would bet you we spend 60% of our effort at work dealing with complexity we have created on ourselves. The inherent complexity is nature of the problem. We cannot get rid of that. Inherent complexity is the nature of the domain. We cannot get rid of it. But accidental complexity is what we can do. We can control. We can remove, right? That is in our hands. And we have to do that. That's very, very important. So I said that simplicity is not clever. Simplicity is not necessarily familiar. Simplicity is not over-engineered. Simplicity is not terse. Now, some people get into this anxiety mode. I want to write the shortest amount of code. Well, sometimes the code is small doesn't mean it is better. It can become very cryptic. Now, look at this code for a second. Have you ever seen code like this before? He's like, yeah, every day at work. Absolutely, we all do, right? And you may say, that's nothing new, I've seen this. Well, actually, I saw this at a client site. And as soon as I saw this code, I said, hey, do you mind if I take a photo of this? And he said, sure, go ahead. And I took a little photo of it. You may say, Venkat, you're really excited. What's funny about this? What's special about this? It's not this code that I was really excited about. It's what I saw below this code. And I saw this. It said, God help me. I have no idea what this means. And you know what this product was or is? This product is a very highly capable engineering application. A single license is $1 million. And the guys who maintain this code are all PhDs in their field. And one of the comments this guy wrote is one of those guys. I see this as like cave paintings, where you're saying, please help, rescue us. We are stranded in this cave. We don't know how to get out. And then you see their bodies next to the paintings, right? That's how I feel about this. This is sad. We see this all the time in code. We don't understand what this code means, and yet we have to maintain this code. That's accidental complexity. We created this on ourselves. Nobody told us you gotta write a cryptic code like this. We chose to do it. So the next time you name a variable, ask yourselves, how would you feel if mom and dad named you P? You say, what's your name, child? P. Is that your initial? No, my full name is P. That's all your mom and dad did, that's it. How would you feel? Well, then don't name your children P. Don't name your variables P. Give respect it. Give it a good name, right? Not a long name. Long names are not necessarily good, right? Give it a respectable name so it's easier for us to understand what it's for. Look at this code for a second. This is an exception test. What does this exception test do? It says over here, given this verbose exception that I named it that way, it says set price, call the max profit, and make sure this code fails with an exception. So this code passes if it has an exception. If there's no exception, it should fail. So you can see that the catch is happy. Well, this is an JUnit. MUnit, those of you who program in C#, had this feature called, you can put an annotation or attribute and say, expected exception. So when JUnit was adapted to Java 5, they said, hey, look, now Java has annotations. And they said, look, the NUnit guys have been using attributes. We can do this too. and they put annotations on it. So you can say expected exception and then specify that. Well, I don't like this. I refuse to write code like this. In fact, I complained about this even in N unit, but in a couple of years, the N unit guys are very smart. They waited long enough for Java to pick this up. As soon as Java, JUnit picked it up, they deprecated in N unit. You cannot do this in N unit anymore. Why? Because it's a bad idea. What's wrong with this? Well, a test should pass only for one reason. A test should never pass for the wrong reason. If you look at this test will pass only if the max profit method threw exactly that exception, the rod cutter exception. If it throws any other exception, or if it doesn't throw an exception, it will fail. And what about this method? Set price better not throw any exception. Well, what happened to this one? This method would pass if set price throws the exception also. So both the code are not the same. This code would fail for fewer reasons than the other code does. So a better way to write this would be to write this verbose solution. Definitely avoid this so-called terse solution, even though it looks concise, or you can really write a concise solution in Java 8 by saying call set price separately, assert throws, and provide a lambda expression that will control the area of the code that you're looking for. So the point really is you have to make sure that the code is not terse, the code is concise. So what's the difference? Both of them are short. But a terse code will hurt you when you don't expect it. A concise code simply gets the work done. So just because a code is small doesn't mean it's better. It's got to be concise and not terse. So we don't have to confuse concise with terse. Be very careful. Terseness is complexity baked in. Concise is not. So this is a wonderful quote by Tony Hoare. He says there are two ways of constructing a software design. One way is to make it so simple that there are obviously no deficiencies. And the other way is to make it so complicated that there are no obvious deficiencies. So we look at this code and say, I don't even know what's wrong with this code. This reminds me of an experience. I was called to a company to come and do a code review. I looked at their code and they said, help us to make this code better. As I was reviewing the code, I suddenly realized in their complex code, there were several pieces where they were not taking care of thread safety. And if multiple threads come and touch this code, bad things can happen. And the minute I realized it, I said, hey guys, did you notice this code doesn't have thread safety? There's a concurrency problem brewing in this code. One of the programmers got very angry and said, hey Venkat, this has been in production for 3 years. What makes you think it can come and scare us today? And how do you answer such a question? Well, thankfully, I didn't have to. Before I could answer the question, one of the other developers said, yeah, but wait a minute. Every 3 weeks, it crashes. We don't know why. So a complex program can do this. We don't even know why the program fails. It really becomes hard to understand what's really going on in the code. So, okay, we talked about what's not simple so far, and maybe we can look for those and avoid them. But would it be sad to leave without at least knowing what is simple? Well, let's try. Let's try to see a few things that are really simple. So the first thing I want to tell you is simple keeps you focused. Simple does not distract you. Simple does not take you on a tangent. Simple does not let you focus your effort somewhere else than where you should be focusing. And what does a simple code do? It draws you in, tells you what you have to do, and you are done. You're not sitting there and saying, I don't understand how this is working. Let me go start researching on this language feature now. Right? If you're familiar with something, it should be easy to understand that. So let's think about this for a second. Let's imagine I'm working on a piece of Java code, and I'm really not sure what function to call. And I know there's a function like this, but I don't know what function really I should call. So what's the most logical thing to do? Is to search, right? Do a quick search, and we can find out what this function is. Reasonable, right? So I'm looking for this function, maybe to reverse this element, and so. Let's try this one more time, can we? Bing. Oh, much better. Oh, beautiful birds. Does anybody know what these birds are? I'm going to say, let's search for it, but I'm afraid another picture is going to show up before that. Once again, a little less distraction, but still distracted. Let's search again, can we? What are we going to look for? What did you see? A text box. What are they telling you? Nothing. What do they want you to do? Get your damn work done. To me, how many of you go to Google? Well, most of us do. Why? Because we? Bing. Oh, much better. Oh, beautiful birds. Does anybody know what these birds are? I'm going to say, let's search for it, but I'm afraid another picture is going to show up before that. Once again, a little less distraction, but still distracted. Let's search again, can we? What are we going to look for? What did you see? A text box. What are they telling you? Nothing. What do they want you to do? Get your damn work done. To me, how many of you go to Google? Well, most of us do. Why? Because you value your time. That is why you go there. You value your time. I value my time. When I want to go for it, look for a Java API, I look for it. If I want to know how somebody is making some history, I will Google for it. I don't want to be distracted by it. Now, do you think this is simple to do? How many people in this room has a courage? Courage, Einstein said, right? It takes courage and such a genius to create something simple. I don't work for Google, by the way, so I'm not promoting Google in any ways. I don't work for them. So I can speak anything about any of these companies. That's the fun of not working for anybody, right? Well, how many of us at work have the courage to say, I'm creating this? Imagine the day, the very first day, when the guy walks into the office and says, hey, I got this interface working. Show me. There you go. And that's it. What do you mean, that's it? What do you have? A text box? Well, okay, I added I'm feeling lucky. Yeah, you should feel lucky to have this job. Do we have the courage to do this at work and say, I'm done? That's it. What do most of us want to do? Put a little clutter. We have to. Why? Because we won't be valuable if we don't clutter this up. Simplicity is weak. Simplicity cannot be good. Simplicity cannot be useful. And what does this tell us? Every one of them is a myth. And why do everybody in this room use this, most of us at least, use this? Because it provides value and it doesn't distract us. We go there and it tells you, thanks for coming, now get your work done and leave. That is why I go there every day, because I can be focused, right? And to me, that is extremely important. A good code is like that. It keeps your focus, doesn't distract you, doesn't tell you stuff you don't need to know, doesn't confuse the heck out of you, and keeps you focused and says, that's all I'm doing, nothing more and nothing less, right? That is hard. It is easy to create this. It is easy to create anything else, but it's very difficult to create simple things that keeps focus. This is a wonderful quote by Antonio D. Salisbury. He says, perfection is achieved not when there is nothing more to add, but when there is nothing left to take away. The real beauty, the real perfection is when we have less. When we have the absolute minimum, the absolute essence, just to get things done. So we can help the task on hand without distracting it. That is the beauty of really creating simple things. Not easy, but that's what we should really strive for. So simple eliminates accidental complexity and really hides the inherent complexity so it becomes manageable. So we have to eliminate these accidental complexities and hide the inherent complexity that we have. So I said simple. What is simple? Simple keeps me focused. It doesn't distract me. The next thing I'm going to say is simple is something that fails less. When you have mutable variables, it fails more. Too many moving parts, I mentioned. It becomes hard to maintain, hard to understand. Too many logic. I had a piece of code somebody gave me one day, and he said, hey, Venkat, I've written this code, and this is the code I wrote. I cannot understand why it doesn't work. Can you help me? This guy said. And it's not long code, 20 lines of code. I'm looking through the code, and I said, oh, given this input, this should be the output. He says, yeah, right, isn't it? But it's not. It gives me something else. Why? So we both are looking at the code like fools. And about 15 minutes later, we're stepping through every line of code. And then I come to the seventh line of code, and he takes the parameter, does the operation on it, and sets it back into the parameter. I said, wait. Did he just change the input parameter? And the minute I mentioned that, he's like, oh, darn it, I know what I did wrong. Never mind, he walks away. And the problem is found. Because our mind doesn't think we would do something as silly as change something given to us. Mutability is evil, and we should avoid it. Good books like Joshua Bloch's Effective Java tell us, right? Promote immutability, avoid mutability. Why do they say that? The reason is mutable code is something that fails a lot more. It's hard to reason code that changes rapidly the state of an object. We are smart, but we're not capable. We are, to err as human, we get confused so easily. We're not good enough to maintain those things in our mind. Now, you probably have been asked this question before. Why is the manhole round in shape? Anybody? Don't worry about being wrong. Just give it a try. I'm wrong most of the time. Please, yeah, go ahead. It will not fall down. You are right. In fact, that phone confirms you are right, right? Absolutely. I like this. When you give the right answer, the phone rings. Excellent. That's right. But that's not the only reason why this is. That's correct, but partly correct. In fact, change the problem a little bit around just for our entertainment purposes. Don't tell people, I want to fill a manhole, give me a round disc. That's easy. Don't tell them that. You tell them, find me something that doesn't fall in. Do you think people are going to come up with a circle? In fact, they did not. Some of the designs proposed were these, because all of these have the property you mentioned as well. None of these will fall into the hole as well. But the circle has one property none of these have. Do you know what that is? Thank you. That absolutely is. At the end of the very long day, this guy is coming out of the hole, and you're all tired, you want to go home. And everybody's waiting around and says, why don't you put the lid and let's go? And the dude says, which direction do I put in? Why don't you do the damn thing there and walk away? We don't have time for that. You're right. The last thing you want to do when you get out of the manhole is to try to do engineering. And say, does it go this way or that way? And the instrument says, face north. Now you're like, which way is north? It's dark already. Right? It's very simple. It fits any way you want to fit in. Now, think about this for a minute. I travel a lot. I work long hours. So to be tired is human nature. When you're tired, what happens? You're confused. When you're tired, what happens? Your brain kind of fuzzes up. The other day, I pulled up to the gas station. And I said, I want to fill up gas. And I'm tired. And I drive my car, and I pick up this nozzle, and it doesn't fit. I'm like, OK, I'm tired. Can you just work, please? What's the problem? And then I calmed down and said, let me think about this. Why doesn't this work? And then it says diesel only. And I'm so thankful it didn't fit. Because if it had fit the wrong one, I would put diesel into my petrol car, and it would have been a total mess that night. Right? A great design. It doesn't fit. Because it's not intended for this purpose, right? So a good design fails less. That's very important. Simple is easier to understand and easier to work with. Now, let's think about a few examples of this. I'm going to go through some complex code or unfamiliar code, but we'll figure out. So I want to find prime numbers. We know what a prime number is. A prime number is a number that is divisible by the number itself and by one. Oh, great. How do we find a prime number? Almost everybody in this room who writes code has written a code to find prime numbers at some point, right? And how do we do this? A for loop, and you check within the for loop, and you decide whether it's divisible. That's what we do. So we could do that. But how about this example? Is divisible by tells me whether a given number is divisible by this number. Great. So I got a function called is divisible by. Then I said, is prime number, if number is greater than 1, because 1 is not a prime number, and infinite collection, stream.int range 2 to max square root of the number, plus 1. So this is the generator, this is the range for the number. None match is divisible by. So I simply said, go ahead and find me a series of numbers where none of those numbers in the range match this criteria called is divisible by. Very expressive, very unfamiliar, and no looping externally, right? So we could think about writing code like this rather than writing the imperative style of code we used to write. Let's entertain one more thought. Primes starting at, I want all the prime numbers starting at a given number. Well, how do I do this? So is prime starting, and I say return concatenation of, meaning given a number, take this number if it's a prime, and concatenate with all the primes that follow. Otherwise, skip that number and only give me all the primes that follow. So concatenate with the primes that follow or just the primes that follow. Now, if you run this code, it won't work. It'll give you a stack overflow exception because it's an infinite recursion and it would never run. But entertain this thought for a minute. Wouldn't it be so cool to write code like this if it would only run? How expressive the code becomes because we can quickly express saying, oh, all primes starting this number are this value if it's a prime, followed by all the primes, or remove that value and all the primes. Recursion is awesome for that expressiveness. How do we do that? Well, actually, we can do that, as you can see here in this example. So what did I do? I said next prime, if the number is a prime, give it to me. Otherwise, go back and ask for the next prime's number. So that's a recursion. And then in this case, I say primes. It starts with the starting number and a count. And what are we doing in this case? I'm saying, go ahead and iterate. But what are we iterating across? From the next prime, or the starting number, and that becomes a generator. Again, a very unfamiliar code for a lot of us in this room. But think about this. I say, give me a stream from the next number to the generator, and give me only a limit of that number of elements, and give me a list. Well, this is called an infinite collection. Now, how do you do an infinite collection in Java 6, Java 7, Java 5? Short answer, you cannot. What about languages like Clojure? Languages like F-sharp on the .NET platform, languages like Scala, and languages like C-sharp and Java 8. All of these support infinite collections. Most programmers programming in mainstream languages haven't used it, but programmers using these languages like Clojure and Scala use it all the time. But once we become familiar with infinite collections, we can say, oh, we could build with these infinite collections very quickly. And then notice in this case, what do I do? I say, give me prime starting with 0, but the first 5 prime numbers, and then starting from 100, only the 7 prime numbers, and we can see the list being printed as appropriate, but this is purely using an infinite collection rather than the traditional approach. Simple is elegant. Now, think about this for a second. Why is this considered to be the most beautiful painting in the world? In fact, shockingly, did you notice the most beautiful painting in the world is a painting of a lady who is simple, doesn't have any ornaments, no, you know, glary jewels, nothing really, just natural. And you look at it, she draws you in. You feel calm, at least you should. Why is that? That is amazingly beautiful, but why? Simple elegance. No clutter. What is there that you could remove from there? Absolutely nothing. Pure elegance, isn't it? This is the work of a genius, we say. But what did the genius do to get the work done? Something very simple. Right? And that is why this is most amazing. I'll talk about an architect's dilemma. When I talk about architects, I'm talking about the real architects, not the computer programmer architects, the guys who build buildings. There is a beautiful church outside of Boston, well, in Boston downtown. This church is called the Trinity Church. And I was walking by the Trinity Church, and I do have to admit, it is beautiful. And you look at this church, it is a beautiful church. The cameras don't do a good job. When you stand there, the church is beautiful. And so they have this beautiful Trinity Church in downtown Boston. And one of the companies wanted to build a high rise next to this church. And the city said, no, we will not let you build a high rise next to this church because we don't want the beauty of the church to be affected in any way. When you're standing next to the church, we want to make sure the beauty is still there. We don't want to do it. The architect said, no, I'm going to build a building here, and it would only improve the beauty of this church. And you may say, how could you improve the beauty of a church by building a building next to it? Are you going to do something to the church? No, I will not even touch it. I won't even come near it. It's going to be beautiful. And I have to admit to you, I did not appreciate the church. I was actually standing for a long time until my family said, do you think we can really go? We've been here for too long. I kept staring at this church, but not at the church, but at the reflection of the church through these beautiful glasses. And this is one of the most amazing sights in Boston, in my opinion. You stand and you are mesmerized by the reflection of this church called the Trinity Church. And this building is called the Dan Hancock Building. It is just a beautiful building. And you stand there and it's an amazing reflection of the church from different angles of this building. What a nice angle of the building, nice reflective glasses, very elegant. And very simple way to solve the problem on hand is I don't want to mess with the church. I want to improve its beauty. And in fact, it's more beautiful now to see the reflection of the church than to see the church itself in a way. And that is, again, an example of what we could do with it. But the last thing I want to tell you here is that we cannot create things that are simple. It has to evolve. You cannot sit at work and say, today I'm going to create something simple and go home. No, you have to earn it. You have to work for it. You got to struggle and you have to get to something that is simple, arrive at something simple. It's got to evolve and that takes time and effort. So Richard Feynman said, if you cannot explain something to a first year student, then you haven't really understood it. Now, this is a bit extreme. But this is a guy who won Nobel Prize for quantum physics. So a guy who won Nobel Prize for quantum physics tells you, if you cannot explain quantum physics to a first-year student, then you haven't understood it. And that is very true. Because a lot of times, when we cannot make somebody understand something, it's not a reflection of the person who is trying to understand. It's a reflection of the person who is trying to explain. That person hasn't understood it. I was teaching for about 7 years a topic. At the end of 7 years, you would say, Venkat, you know everything, right? Well, now I know no. And I was explaining something in the class, and nobody got it on the 7th year. And I'm like, why don't you guys get it? They're like, I don't know. We don't understand. What are you talking about? I said, you know what? Never mind. Forget it. I'll come back tomorrow and explain it. So I went home. I spent late into the night working on it, and I said, why doesn't the class get it? And all of a sudden, about midnight, past midnight, it suddenly dawned on me. I haven't understood it. And I've been teaching this for 7 years. That's a very shocking moment of truth, right? It's like, you've been teaching, this doesn't mean you understand it. And I suddenly realized, oh, and it's suddenly like you peel the layer of onion, and there's more inside of it. And you've gone through a layer of understanding, and you move it, and there was more to understand, and there was clarity all of a sudden. And the next day I came and said, let me explain, and 5 minutes explain, and everybody's like, that is so simple, why did you have so much trouble explaining this yesterday? And I said, it's very simple, I didn't know this yesterday. I just learned it last night. Now I'm able to explain it better. So sometimes you have to understand what you don't understand so you can go back and explain it better. And that takes some time. So we have to evolve that over time as well. Now, Occam's razor says that if you have two solutions to the same problem, and if both the solutions produce the same result, we got to look for the simplest of those two solutions. That is very critical. Now, over the holidays, I decided I want to write a book. And I normally write my books in about 2 weeks. I don't have time. I travel about 200,000 miles a year. So time is very difficult for me to find. So normally I would keep thinking a lot about books, and I would take 2 weeks in a year and just cram through and write books in the 2 weeks. Those 2 weeks are a very entertaining period for my family because I would be home, but they would never see me. I would wake up way early in the morning, work late till the night, and I have the door closed. My family normally slides food under the door. So every few hours, food comes to the door, I eat that and I just stay there. And if they ever see me during the time, they would see me that I've not shaved, all the hygiene goes through the door. So sometimes the children would, if I get lazy, they would say, oh, daddy, you're growing a beard and writing another book. So usually I write my books in about 2 weeks period, I cram through. So the time is very, very important. So this holiday, I decided I'm going to write a book on Java 8. Java 8 is just coming around the corner, great time to think about writing a book. So I started writing a book on Java 8. And as I was writing the book, I said to myself, it'd be so cool to talk about certain things we can do in other languages, like Scala, like Groovy, like Clojure, like F-sharp. All these languages, wouldn't be so cool to say about a few things that can be done in there. So what I wanted to do was, I wanted to implement a tail call optimization. What is tail call optimization? Well, recursion, we all know what recursion is. One of the problems with recursion is, like in this example, I have a factorial. Number equals 1, return number, otherwise return number times factorial of number minus 1. This will run fine for a small number, but for a very large number, you'll get a stack overflow exception. So recursions don't work when the input size is big. Tail call optimization is a wonderful idea that was introduced in this fantastic book called Structure and Interpretation of Computer Programs. I highly recommend this book. It talks about a process versus a procedure. A procedure is the code we write, a process is what runs under the hood. And you can write a recursion and run as a recursion, it'll fail for a large number. You can write an iteration, runs as an iteration, but that's mutation most of the time. But if we can write it as a recursion, but through optimization it can run as an iteration, you get the best of both worlds. So this gives you quite a bit of benefit on your hand if you can do that. Well, that's great, we can do that. But how do I do that in Java 8? Well, immediately I started researching to find out if I can do tail call optimization in Java 8. And no, you cannot do tail call optimization in Java 8. And you know one thing about programmers, they never take no for an answer. I said, well, Java 8 doesn't do it, but can we do it? Well, I have one benefit, fortunately. And that is, I know how this works in Scala. And Scala does this through compiler support. Well, that's ruled out. I cannot do that. Why? Because Java compiler doesn't support it, so I cannot use the compiler help. I know how Clojure does it. Again, the language supports it inherently. I cannot do that. Well, I know how Groovy supports it. And they do this very cleverly through library support, but I cannot do that also because in Groovy, it's dynamically typed. Java is not dynamically typed. It's statically typed. How do I do that? So right in the middle of writing the book, I gave up on writing the book. This was more interesting than writing the book. I wanted to research on this. And I have to tell you, I spent about 20 hours on this code just trying to figure out how to make tail call optimization work. And late in the night, I barely had a code that got together and started working. And it was very clumsy, but there was a sign that this was actually going to work. I said, this is great. It's going to work now, right? The sign of hope you get when something is going to work, but it's all a total mess. And I said, okay, 20 hours later, this seems to be working. I'll come back and take a look at it again. So the next day I came and looked at the code. It was a total mess, but I know it can work. The feasibility study is over. Now I want to write this code. So I wrote the code. And it took me about 10 hours to write this code now, right? To refactor and make it kind of presentable. Because in a book, you have to present something that actually others can understand as well, isn't it? But at the end of this time, it was hard to explain it, hard to really convey what's happening, but more refactoring later. And eventually, I ended up with something like this. Factorial, and I have a fact and a number. If number is 1, return a done of fact. Otherwise, return a lambda expression of a call to factorial of that multiplication. Don't try to read too much into the code, but it's a recursion implemented using tail call optimization. And then I call that method. That works, but there's a lot of things that are not known here. What does done mean? What does call mean? So here's the code for done and call after 10 hours of effort. And I have this code, a tail calls class, and I have a method called interface called isComplete, and I have a method called result and apply. So these methods are providing a certain behavior or interface for tail call optimization. And the code itself is something like this. isComplete returns a false as a default implementation and a return null for a result. And I have a method, here's what the code of the solution is, invoke. And what the invoke says is, tell me if this is complete. If it is not complete, get me the next tail call operation, perform it, and then check if it is complete. Otherwise, check it is complete. Otherwise, check the next is complete. Pure recursion. That is all the code is, about 20 lines of code, give or take. Well, great, Venkat, 20 lines of code, you're done, right? Well, there was one problem in the code. The problem in this code is, after all this effort, 25 hours plus 10 hours, right in the middle of getting this job done, is notice this line of code right here. Call complete equals current dot is complete. What is that doing? What is that doing? Mutating, isn't it? And you probably heard me several times today saying, avoid mutability, didn't I? Well, if I'm saying that several times now, guess what I was telling in the book? Almost in every chapter, several times I told people, don't use mutability. And now what am I using? Mutability. So sitting and worrying about this, what do I do? So I came with a few solutions. The first solution was, remember I told you don't use mutability? Well, don't use it unless it's unavoidable like this. That was my first answer. And you're all laughing already. And that's the way I felt about it. I said, no, I don't want to write it. Then I came up with a much better answer, one that I'm sure you would love. I said, do you see I'm using mutability? I leave it as the exercise to the reader to make it immutable. Meaning your author has no clue what he's talking about, right? And I wrote that. And I knew, this is really not good. And I told myself, no, I've got to find a way to remove this mutability. But how? And I had no clue how to do it. And I realized one thing. My code simply sucks. And I'm not happy with it. But I don't know how to solve it. And what do you do when you don't know what to solve it? You bang your head against the wall. What does it do? It either breaks your head or breaks the wall or both. It doesn't solve real problems. So I said, all right, I'll come back to it. I'll think about it. And I went away. And the next morning, I was on the treadmill. I was jogging and far away from my computer. Went on doing other things, right? And as I was jogging on the computer, slowly my little thread in my head is thinking about this problem one more time and one more time. And all of a sudden, I yelled out, oh gosh, of course. Why didn't I think of that stupid little solution? And I jump off the treadmill, run over to my desk with my family saying, is everything okay? I'm like, yes, I found the answer, right? And I run to the desk, and I completely refactored the code. And what in effect of the code was this. I said, invoke, stream iterate, call from the current object apply method, is the call complete, find first, get me the result. For one, notice there's no loop, not an external loop. What am I using really? Well, I'm using what is called an infinite collection and combined with another feature called lazy collections. You may say, wait, infinite collection and lazy collection. How would anybody know about it? Well, good news. I spoke about that in the previous chapter in the book. So the reader knows about this already. I didn't know about it, right? That I could use it. And once I realized it, complete mutability was gone. Poof, like that. And the problem simply said, think of a recursion as an infinite series. Now think about it for a minute. Recursion, we think of a loop where you call a function, and then you call the function again, and then you call the function again. Rather than thinking it that way, just imagine, close your mind and imagine that you have this recursion where each function is a little box. And each of the functions is connected by a thread forming a train of these boxes. How many can you have? We don't know. Because we don't know how many levels we're going to iterate of recursion. So it's an infinite recursion. Well, okay, that's great. Now that I have this infinite recursion, just apply each of the recursion until the first one says, I am done, and you don't have to go anymore. Well, that came great so far, but how do you deal with an infinite recursion because you cannot have infinite memory? Well, you don't need infinite memory because the infinite recursions are lazy recursion, meaning they do things on demand. They don't do it ahead of time. So this is an infinite recursion, and the find first says, only do as much work as needed, but nothing more, and it's very optimized for that. So it fizzled down to just about 3-4 lines of code with no mutability, but it really required 35 hours of struggle and a run on the treadmill to find the answer. Sometimes the best solutions come to us when we are detached from the problem. So if you're struggling with something and you don't know how to do it, take a break, walk away, go to a park, enjoy a nice walk, take a cup of coffee. Sometimes I don't watch TV, but the only time I sit in front of a TV is when I'm trying to solve a very hard problem. I'll be sitting in front of the TV, sipping a coffee, and people would say, oh, did you hear that news? I'd say, what news? On the TV, so what TV? I'm not even watching it, right? My brain is detached from my surrounding. I'm sitting away from that, but I'm just getting away from the code. That's what I'm doing. And suddenly I'm like, oh, yes, of course, I could do that. And then right away go, and you have a better solution on hand. So a lot of times you solve a problem by walking away from it. Why is that? Because our mind is very clever, but it gets engaged and get tangled. And you have to untangle it and re-engage it for it to find the problem and the solution. And sometimes, this is why sometimes you go talk to other people. If you go to somebody and say, hey, let me explain to you what the problem is I'm having, and halfway through explaining, you probably stop and say, you know what, never mind, I found the answer. And the person is like, I'm glad I could help, right? And said nothing else to you. Why is this happening? Because you detach from the problem, and then you re-engage your mind, and you're able to find a solution. So if you want to find something simple, take the time to find something simple. Evolve simplicity. Walk away from the problem and come back and you may find something better than what you're trying to do. Putting more hours on a problem doesn't yield the result. Sometimes you have to work efficiently, not work just hard, right? And the efficiency comes from walking away sometimes and re-engaging the mind. And we are more creative in finding the solutions after that point. So it has to evolve. Again, as Einstein said, everything should be made simple as possible, but not any simpler. But the question to ask is this simple? Or can this be simpler? So this is what one of the things I do. Anytime I create something, I don't accept it as being simple. I give it right away to people. People who are smarter than me. People who think different than me. And I tell them, hey, critique my work. Tell me what you think. And sometimes they say, oh, this is great. But a lot of times they say, why don't you do this? And now I have something better. So how do I know what I did is simple? Or can it be simpler? Well, now I believe that simplicity is like a Schrodinger's cat. The code is probably simple and complex at the same time. It is simple because I can understand it. It is probably complex because it probably can be simpler. It depends on the perspective of the person looking at it as well. It is very subjective. But I believe that we can make things simple by evolving it, by getting feedback from others, by showing it to other people. It is a lot of effort. It is a lot of struggle. It is something that doesn't come too easily. It's something that we have to work really hard for to achieve that. And we have to take the time to do that. Simple makes things easy, but it certainly is not easy at all. But every minute we spend on it is worth it, because as Da Vinci said, that simplicity is the ultimate sophistication in life, and it is well worth it. Thanks for your time. We have time for questions, 5 minutes for questions. Yeah. So anything you want to talk about, share about, would be delighted to hear. Don't be shy. If nobody asks questions, Naresh will, so I would rather hear from you. You don't have to ask a simple question, it can be a complex question. Go for it, thank you. Please.
Yeah,
I will hear you, go ahead. So very good question. So the question that you asked was, you know, hey, we got projects, time has been estimated, budget has been estimated, all these has been estimated. How practically can we realize what we want to realize given all these constraints? Sums up your question? I usually say about this guy who walks into a bar, always a nice thing to think about, right? A guy walks into the bar, finds this young, beautiful lady, and rushes to her and says, sweetie, we're going to get married. This is the day we're going to get married, on June the 7th. We're going to have 4 children. Here are their genders. Here are their names. Here's where they're going to go to school. Here's where we're going to live. Here's where we're going to retire. He says all of this. And this lady is in panic and says, who are you? Well, the guy says, I'm a traditional project manager. Now, this is absurd, right? Nobody in the right mind would do things. And yet, that's what we see at work every day. We have people come to us and say, we got all of this figured out. All you have to do is just show up and just get your work done. And that's a fallacy. Now, we all talk about agile. Now, what does it really mean, agile development? Agile development is really about getting the feedback, trying to learn about where we are and steer to where we need to go with the most efficiency we can, based on the realities of what we know. That doesn't mean don't plan, don't have a vision. But what it means is only commit to what you can know at the moment and postpone things to a time when you can get better idea about it. That is very critical. So if we want to fix everything, we have fixed one thing. That's called failure. And that comes as part of a package of that. So the reality is we plan only as much as we can really know. And the key is adaptive planning. And if we are not doing adaptive planning, I don't care what they call it as, it is not giving them success, right? So I'm not interested in the word agile, because what is the point in failing with the word agile? I would rather succeed and not know what I did to succeed, rather than saying I was agile and failed with it. So adaptive planning is extremely important. These problems don't go away because we use the word agile. These go away because we change our behavior. And until we are ready to change our behavior, we cannot expect better results. So there's no short answer for your question. It's not that simple. Any other questions or comments? One more, maybe.
Yes, I got
Yes.
Sorry.
Oh, go ahead, please. Yes.
Yeah, just listening to your thing and how to make it simple, especially on the design that don't go the complex way, just like you phoned your colleague and said that when there's no requirement, you just need to think of the current requirement, just do it simple,
yes.
In simple way. Because I worked in a project where exactly, you got a team of technical architects. They made it simple, they considered only that requirement, they did it, and then there was another change in requirement, but when the technical architect decided, yes, this is a change, but this would the effort has gone up. And the customer was like, I thought your technical architects would design in such a way that's scalable and there'd be less rework. So
that's a great question. So let's think about it for a minute. You have a problem and it's very clear. But the solution to the problem is not to do more complex things, because that doesn't work either. So we need to understand what went wrong here. What went wrong here is we are doing something based on what we know now, and something later comes up that doesn't fit into what we're doing. And a way to tackle this is, don't do stuff that come by your way. This is kind of goes back to what, related to what you were saying. Agile doesn't mean we only take what we have on hand and do it. You have to step back and get a global picture of what your overall goal is, and then you have to prioritize based on two things. What's the most valuable and the most architecturally impactful? And if I were to do what's most valuable and most architecturally impactful, and then when I come back later, what I'm going to get is going to be less valuable and less impactful, it should be easier to handle it or not as important to it. This is, that doesn't eliminate the problems, but it can reduce the problem to a great extent. The chances of running into something that you talked about would be less in that case, because we prioritize them based on value and impact in that way. Is it possible that business changes randomly and we off the bat get something that we never expected? Oh, absolutely, I hope we do. And when we do, that's called karma, right? And we better deal with it. There's no point in saying, I will be extensible forever. No. Well, you know what, we did our best, and here's what we did to minimize all these, but when a risk like that happens, let's deal with it. And what do we do with that time? We say, well, this is so important now, let's do that now, and because we have done more important things until now and fewer, less important things now, we can insert this right now, and the time we are spending on this, we could remove some features towards the end that are less important, but don't worry about it. The ones that are important are already done. Again, the prioritization can help. Again, that's something we need to keep in mind in agile development. Agile development is not running wild without any planning, right? So to plan everything is dangerous. To plan nothing is more dangerous. It's a pendulum we have to be very watchful of, and the pendulum has to strike a balance. The other extreme is we'll plan all day and get nothing done, and all the plan is obsolete by the time we finish it. This extreme is, hey, we will never plan anything and we'll be shocked every time we see something new. Well, the nice balance is, let's prioritize these and try to understand where are we going and what is a better route to go based on what we know, and then of course make adjustments along the way. That becomes very important as well. Well, I'll be around here for today and tomorrow. We'd be delighted to talk to you further at any time off the stage. So thank you very much.